You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple and beyond.
Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 109, Influences, Ian Paice with Daniel Glass. And coming to you from the suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, I'm your co-host, John Cookie Dough Mottola.
No. Now, based on the last few episodes, this means you either like or do not like cookie dough. And I'm going to guess you like it.
Yes, because here's a little piece right now that I'm eating.
You're just eating cookie
while
dough?
We're recording.
Oh, my God.
I've been thinking about it. Yeah. I didn't have time to turn it into a cookie, so it's going to be the dough. I've been thinking about it. I was thinking about it through, like, I don't know, for a while. So I cut it up into four little equal quadrants, and now I'm just having little bites.
What kind of cookie is it? Just traditional chocolate chip cookie?
It is double chocolate.
Ooh, you got my raw eggs.
Yeah, never hurt nobody.
Yeah, there you go. That's fine.
Look at Rocky.
Rocky did just fine.
You can get salmonella or nothing.
Nope. Hey, so if you want to help support the Deep Purple Podcast, there's a few ways to do it. First, leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Why don't you? It only takes a minute of your time. We really appreciate it. It helps new people discover the show. You can buy some of our merch at our Etsy store, and then you can also become a patron on Patreon or PayPal for as little as $1 a month. You can help support the show. You can help buy flour, sugar, eggs, and chocolate so that John can make his homemade cookie dough there and just sit there and eat it during the show. We'd really, really appreciate that. And speaking of patrons, oh my goodness, coming in here at the executive level, we've got the $20 Shades of Deep Pockets tier, Ryan M at the $15 Highball Shooter tier, Alan Ain't Too Proud to Beg, the Turn It Up to $11 tier, Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Clay Wambacher, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 Someone Came tier, Steve Seaborg of nameonanything.com and alltheworldsastage.net, Jeff Bryce and Gerald Kelly, and also Victor Campos and Richard Fusey. Thank you to all of you for your support of the Deep Purple Podcast. We really appreciate it. Then also check out deepdivepodcastnetwork.com. We've got 8 shows in the network right now. Don't ask me to name them all off the top of my head, but we got some great, great shows. And if I tried to name them off the top of my head, I would be sure to leave someone out and make them feel bad. Really appreciate the Deep Dive, all those great podcasts in our little makeshift network that we have here. Thank you so much. Then Apple Podcast reviews for this week. Our review is coming to us from, oh my goodness, I didn't write it down, but I think it's Great Britain or the UK. This one is from August. It is Far 70, 5 stars. Wait, the subject line is Philip H. So I don't know what that means. But anyway, maybe that's Philip H. Farr. I don't know. But I was happy about this one because he said, I heard this site mentioned by Ian Paice on his YouTube channel, so decided to Google it and subscribe. And the few shows I've heard have been excellent. So thank you, Philip or Farr. We appreciate that.
Wow.
You know, Ian did. I did write in a question to Ian last summer, and he responded to it and put up briefly the Deep Purple Podcast on there. So I was like, oh, cool. So nice. I can't believe we actually got a listener from that. Thank you. That's really great. Nice. And then, I'm going to try not to get emotional here, but our good friend, Mike Erickson. So I went to the mailbox the other day. I was very excited because I was expecting my CD copy of the new Ray Fenwick anthology, which I just got in. So I ran to the mailbox and I was like, it's not there on the release date. But I went there and I had this letter in the mail with these stamps from Sweden, and it's from our old friend, Mike Erickson.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, oh, Mike Erickson sending me a letter in the mail. Well, that's unusual. I wonder what this is about. So inside is this letter, and I'll hold it up right there. But it's just a little envelope, and it says, "Found this. I think you should have it, Mike Erickson." I said, "What the heck is this going to be?" And I opened it up, and John, I kid you not, I was almost brought to tears when I looked inside what was in here. And here it is. It's a ticket stub from the Butterfly Ball performance at the Royal Albert Hall.
Wow.
And £1 entry fee to see that show.
Oh, my
seems,
God.
Seems reasonable. Row 5, seat 33.
It's a real ticket.
It's a real ticket stub. Honest to goodness ticket stub. And I was like misty-eyed. I'm sitting there like at the mailbox like, I'm like, oh, my God. Because it's just like, obviously, if you listen to the show, you know how important the Butterfly Ball is to me. That concert is to me. And to just to see this, and not only that, just the fact that he found this and knew enough about the show and about us, and that he's like, you know, you should have this, and bothered to send it to me, is just like touching on so many different levels. So I was really, really blown away by that, and really appreciative, Mike, that you sent that along to us.
You need to frame that baby.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, I was almost like, should I do like a frame with that Butterfly Ball poster back there?
Yeah. That's the poster I've,
and put like a little second thing down below.
Yeah.
I need to. So I'm like, I need to go to the frame store. Mike, you just cost me like $200 and getting a frame made.
Totally worth it. Worth it.
Such a great piece of history, and I've even Googled it before, and I think I've seen found ticket stubs and or stuff, and just been like, oh, that those are kind of pricey. So I think it's even got
and it's in great condition.
Yeah, it's great condition, and it looks
pristine.
I'm looking it up right now. I know I've looked for ticket stubs for things that were kind of important before, and I think this one, yeah, I've looked for this one and I can't even find it. I'm looking right now.
That's how rare it is.
It's rare. And if I could find it, it would probably be kind of pricey. Is this? No, that's some other thing at the Royal Albert Hall. So yeah, I'm not even finding anything for it right now. Of course, with anything, I'm reminded of my quest for finding Butterfly Ball stuff back in the mid 90s, Iron Butterfly ticket stubs popping up. It's always Iron. For those of you that don't know, Iron Butterfly has an album entitled Ball. So finding Butterfly Ball was nearly impossible before it became actually accessible. So
see, now what needs to happen next is you get Roger Glover to sign that.
Oh my goodness.
And then you can die a happy man.
Well, you know what? He could sign my album. That would be actually, I got nothing with the frame yet. I get Roger Glover to sign my album. I get the original concert poster there, the ticket stub, boom, the whole kit and caboodle. That'd be great.
Nate Shrine right back there.
Exactly. That'd be perfect. But all right. So this week we're coming at you with something a little bit different. We've connected with this gentleman, Daniel Glass, on social media, a great drummer, educator, music guy, author, podcaster, you name it. Bricklayer, mason, what, electrician? I don't know, he can do it all. And we decided to invite him on the show to talk about Ian Paice being one of his bigger influences in his kind of experience with Ian Paice and with Deep Purple. So without further ado, we'll take you to that segment of the show. But actually, there is further ado, because before we get there, we do have to thank our core level patrons. Coming in at the $6.66 tier, we have nobody, because Richard Fusey is upgraded. If you want to join us, please join us at the $6.66 tier. At the $5.99 nice price tier, we have Fielding Fowler and Dr. Jill Breese. At the $5 moneylender tier, Greg Sealby, John Convery, Arthur Smith, German Heindel, Adrian Hernandez, Kenny Wymore, Jesper Alman, Alexi the Perfect Stranger Slepikoff, James North, Mark Hodgetts, Kev Roberts, and Will Porter. And at the $3 Nobody's Perfect tier, Peter Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Anton Glaving, Andrew Meyer, Duncan Leesk, and Stuart McCord, sipping his whiskey by the fire. Thank you to all of our wonderful patrons. And now on to our talk with Daniel Glass. All right. This week we are joined by Daniel Glass, who is here to talk about Ian Paice and Deep Purple. Trying something a little new this week and talking about getting some storied musicians on and to talk about their background with the band and the members of the band. So Daniel, thank you so much for joining us.
I'm honored and privileged to be here. I'm a new fan. I'm an old fan of Deep Purple, but I'm a relatively new fan of your podcast, and I'm thrilled to be here to really dig into a bunch of trivia about Deep Purple.
Awesome.
Dig into the granular material.
So for our listeners, obviously you are a drummer who is who counts Ian Paice among some of his one of his favorite drummers. You're an author. You were telling us earlier, a music historian. You're a podcaster as well. You've got all this background in music. Tell us a little bit about your background in music and how you got interested in Deep Purple.
My musical life has had a variety of different stages. I grew up in Hawaii, which is very strange. Most people don't grow up there. And you would think Hawaii is a really weird backwater as far as access to what was happening in the world of music. But strangely, it used to be a stop for bands headed to the Far East. So bands going to Australia or Japan, everybody always wanted to stop in Hawaii and have a vacation. And so they would, you know, plan a concert so they could justify having some income come in. And then they would take a few days. So I got to see some unbelievable concerts growing up. I had fairly hip parents. For example, I got to see the Fleetwood Mac Rumors tour, which was, you know, pretty awesome.
Oh, wow.
My parents were mostly folkies. They were a little older than hippies, but they were lefty politically. And a lot of people moved to Hawaii to get away from whatever their life was like on the mainland. So Hawaii in the early 70s was really wide open and all kinds of cool things happening and a big kind of hippie scene or whatever. So my parents hung out with a lot of hippies, even though they weren't hippies themselves. And I got to see like Joan Baez and Arlo Guthrie and those kind of folks in concert when I was a kid. When I was 9, my best friend was 12, which when you're 9 and 12, that's kind of an enormous difference in age.
Not sure.
To be hanging out with somebody as much as I did. And he was into much more adult things than I was, including like marijuana, which, you know, was in Hawaii in the 70s was like literally growing on trees pretty much.
It was pretty easy to come by.
Easy to come by. Yes.
There wasn't a lot of crackdown on.
No, definitely not. It was definitely like part of the culture. Pakalolo, you know, we call it. But one of the things that he turned me on to four hard rock albums: Dark Side of the Moon, Aerosmith, Get Your Wings, Black Sabbath, Paranoid, and Deep Purple, Made in Japan. This was probably 1974. So all these albums were fairly new at that time. I was 9 or 8 and my mind was blown by this music. And I just remember, you know, just I fell in love with Deep Purple at that point. And I noticed that, and I was sort of starting to play drums myself. I didn't get a drum set till I was 12 or 13, but I was taking lessons from the time I was 7 and was really open to drummers. And I noticed, you know, as I got older, when it came time, how do I set up the drums? I'm a left-hander. And so Ian Paice, oh, I saw set up different than all the other drummers. And I went, okay, I'm left-handed, so I will, I must set up the same way. So I am a left-handed drummer because of Ian Paice. He became my first drum hero. And I got into Deep Purple that way.
Are drummers like guitarists a lot of times, where left-handers will just play right hand because that's what's set up for them or what's available?
Absolutely. You have to go through a lot of hassle to set up. And everybody calls it backwards, but I don't like to say that. I like to say opposite. I set up opposite of everybody else, you know. So, So I got really into Deep Purple. I started, when I finally did get into bands, the first band I was in was called Living Wreck, which we named after the Deep Purple song. We played, actually, that band was a Sabbath tribute band. So here I am. This was when I was like,
that's funny.
In, this is about 79 now. I was in eighth grade and I got grabbed by a bunch of ninth graders. I was always hanging out with older guys, which was cool. But to be in their band, and we played like almost entirely Black Sabbath music, which I thought was great. Mm-hmm. There really wasn't such a thing as tribute bands, I guess, back at that point. So we were maybe a Black Sabbath cover band. So, you know, I was really into hard rock at that time and loved it. So we played a few Deep Purple tunes. I think we played Ring That Neck, and I think we played Smoke on the Water, something like that. But during that time, and I'd written to you about this, what you let me know, this was like 1975. I heard ads on the radio that Deep Purple was coming to Hawaii. And this is one of these questions I had where my whole life, I wondered what tour that was and who was on it. I thought it may have been the Burn or Come Taste the Band, but you told me it was Come Taste the Band, right?
Yeah, it was actually the first show that Tommy Bolin played with them was in Hawaii before they moved out east and had that
exactly
time at, in everywhere else. So
people dying and
yeah, terrible.
Yeah. So anyway, then a couple years later, there were ads on the radio that Deep Purple was coming to Hawaii. This was around 1980, and I was very excited, and I got tickets with the guitar player in my band, and we went down. And what was a little suspicious was that they were playing at the University of Hawaii in the Campus Center Ballroom. And I was like, I don't know. I think they would play the arena. And of course, it was the new Deep Purple, the bogus Deep Purple, whatever people want to call them. So I had a chance to see that band. And like most other people, I was totally disappointed that it was not Deep Purple.
Yeah, you're among the few that got to actually witness that. You didn't see the ad that they took out saying, you know, the following members of Deep Purple will not be performing.
No, I mean, probably they, yeah, no, that never made it to Hawaii. Those kind of things never made it to Hawaii. That was only the LA show or whatever, you know. But anyway, so I was already hip to Burn at that point, and we did a lot of, in that band that I was in, we did a lot of listening, you know, Made in Europe. But Made in Japan, I mean, the problem is I was really spoiled because Made in Japan was the first album that I, of Deep Purple, that I became obsessed with. And then, you know, I just wasn't, I like Machine Head. I've never purchased Machine Head. I don't really listen to it because to me, you know, Space Truckin' and Smoke on the Water and Highway Star, and isn't Lazy on?
Yep.
Is Lazy on Machine Head? Yeah, those are all just subpar.
Can't deal
subpar
with Space Truckin' being anything less than 20 minutes long.
Exactly. I mean, to me, Made in Japan is probably the greatest live album, you know, or one of the greatest live albums ever made. It's just lightning in a bottle all the way through. It's incredible.
It seems to be the general consensus with, I mean, obviously the circles we travel in, but even in Twitter, outside of our Deep Purple sphere, that album just always comes up for obvious reasons. So like as a drummer, then what, I was talking to John about paradiddles on our last episode.
Yes. I listened to that just this very day.
As we talked, our Burn episode just recently came out where we broke down the individual tracks. So
awesome.
I mean, what is it about? I mean, can you, as a drummer and teacher, go into something about Paice's technique and his style and where how it influences you, or where you think it comes from?
Yeah, well, you know, one of the things that I love about all those drummers from that period is that they were reared on jazz, or, you know, at least swing jazz, And one of the things I love studying is the roots of the British invasion, which is just a very interesting time. All those musicians that grew up born at the end of World War II or a little bit later, you know, they were listening to the voice of America. The US obviously had used the UK as a staging point. I mean, certainly when Germany had taken over all of continental Europe, the United States, the only place they could be was in England. And so, you know, big band music, and then after that time period, bebop music and early rock and roll and rhythm and blues, and then in the early 60s, like instrumental rock and girl groups, you know, and all that kind of stuff was being, like, British kids heard all that. They heard it on Voice of America. There were a lot of Americans there. Another really interesting thing that I learned is that, for example, we talk about Liverpool and the Mersey River as being like this important, you know, musical, even though Liverpool is nowhere near London, it's right on the, I guess, on the west coast of UK, of Britain. So all the ships that would bring the records over from America would stop there first, and they would have the pick of all of those before they were put on boats to go down the Mersey River to go to London. So, you know, all this stuff was happening in England. And Ian Paice, you know, as you guys obviously know, have you done a show about Ian Paice specifically yet? Or
no,
I haven't had a chance to look over all your shows, but
no, not focused just on Ian Paice, but we did kind of, whenever a new member of the band joins, obviously for Ian Paice, it would have been right in the original lineup. We did kind of a little bit background on each musician and what they did before they came into Deep Purple. But in the early days, Ian Paice was, I don't know, 17 or something when he joined Deep Purple.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
And he still had a few credits when he was in a band called Maze. MI6, I think it's the same band, but they just changed the name. So he had like a little bit of a background, but obviously not much of a background before he joined Deep Purple.
Well, his father was a big band leader. And so, you know, again, like guys like Mitch Mitchell, Bill Ward, you know, other drummers of that period, John Bonham. I mean, they were exposed to like Max Roach and who's the drummer for Dave Brubeck? Why am I blanking on this? Joe Morello, Gene Krupa. Like they were exposed to, you know, Buddy Rich, of course. So, you know, that there was a lot of that. Those guys could all kind of swing. And when you're sort of, when swing is the first style of music that you're exposed to, it's kind of it stays with you, you know, triplet bass music. I guess you guys are both musicians, so you understand what I'm talking about. But Ian Paice just, so that, you know, what he was exposed to, the fact that he had played big band music, he had a really musical sensibility and had some chops. And when you're talking about paradiddle, singles and doubles, you know, a lot of sort of rock drummers just left, right, left, right, left, right all the time. But I mean, he obviously had some training. Interestingly, like comparatively, John Bonham had no training and yet had his own incredible, incredible style of, technique heavy playing. So, but Ian Paice, you know, not only did he, like, a lot of times we think about big rock drums and we think that was sort of a new phenomenon, but a lot of those guys were copying Gene Krupa, who had a 26 inch or 28 inch bass drum, all those swing era guys, you know, who had big tubby toms, who had very tightly cranked up snares so they could play a lot of fast stuff on the snare. So, you know, John Bonham was the same way. People are talking about, oh, trying to get the Bonham sound. Well, they don't remember that John Bonham's bass drum was empty. You know, there was no muffling in it. It was 28 inches in diameter or 26 inches. And, you know, he tuned his toms up. Even though they were big, they were tuned relatively high so he could get around on them. So not to be too terribly technical, but his style was rooted in jazz. And one of the interesting things, when I met him, we had this interesting conversation because I grew up listening to him and then became a jazz drummer. I mean, most of the music I play these days is jazz and swing. I was at a band for 20 years called Royal Crown Review, which was a which is a swing band, but a swing band that hit you like a rock band.
It's great stuff. And I checked out a couple of the albums, and really, really good stuff.
Yeah. That's how I got connected to you, actually, was Greg Renoff, who I think you know, who wrote the Van Halen, wrote a biography of Van Halen, and he wrote the biography of Ted Templeman. Mm-hmm. And I did a couple albums with Ted. So when that book came out, Greg wrote to me, and because Ted had mentioned me kindly in his autobiography, and the engineer that did a lot of records with us, a guy named Lee Hirschberg, who had done Sinatra records and is a kind of an LA legend also, like, you know, so I got connected to Greg. So I don't know. Am I making sense here? Yes. So when I met Ian Paice, I've met Ian Paice twice, and both times he's like the nicest guy in the world, which you probably get a sense of when you hear him talk. Mm-hmm. And very gracious, you know, didn't know me from Adam. But he, we commented that he was a jazz drummer who took his jazz style and turned it into a rock thing. And I was raised on his rock and roll and took that and turned it into a jazz thing, you know, because I would definitely brought a lot of Ian Paice's style to what I did with Royal Crown Review, you know, or Bill Ward. I mean, I was, you know, or Mitch Mitchell, those kind of guys. Those are the guys that I really loved. I was a fan of hard rock, of 70s hard rock, like you guys probably are. Once things got into the 80s, I was already getting more into prog rock. And then from there, I kind of made the leap to jazz. So what I loved about 70s hard rock is the improvisational factor, the fact that the musicians still wanted to improvise, you know, they wanted to make stuff up on the spot, which is why you have the 20-minute version of Space Truckin', you know, or I was telling you there's another version of Ring That Neck that's 18 minutes long on the in concert.
There's one, I think, that's 32 minutes on one of their I think it's one of those old recordings that used to be a bootleg, and they have finally did an official release maybe 15 years ago. But yeah, it's one of those things that would be I don't even know if they had to split it up when it was on a bootleg record and onto two sides of a double record or something, but crazy how long some of their performances were.
But you with all those bands, Zeppelin was the same way, you know, they would do these long instrumental jams, they were exploring artistically, they were really trying to like get somewhere. Hendrix, you know, I mean, sometimes it was cheesy and it didn't succeed, but like they rock bands were really trying to walk that tightrope between, you know, pushing the boundaries and coming up with something new every night. And that again harkens back to jazz, you know. Benny Goodman, who was, you know, big band leader, if you listen to his concert at Carnegie Hall, which I think is, you should check it out, it's also in my opinion one of the other greatest live albums. It's the first live concert album, and it's that sort of is in the vein. It was recorded in 1938, but it didn't come out till 1959. Oh, wow. Because they didn't have the LP until 1959, and they only had 78s, which could only handle a small amount of music. So the swing bands would do these long jams, but you never heard it because when they would go in the studio, they could only do 3.5 minutes of music at a time. But, you know, these guys probably were listening to these long kind of swing band jams. And they're very similar in a lot of ways to the kind of thing, like, for example, the song Sing, 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 which is the most famous Benny Goodman song, the studio version is like, it's two sides. What they would do is they would record for 3.5 minutes, they would stop, they would record for another 3.5 minutes, and it would be an A and a B side of a 78 RPM record. So it would be Sing, Sing, Sing part one and Sing, Sing, Sing part two. And you'd have to turn the record over, but you could imagine what the whole song sounded like. So by the time they got to the Carnegie Hall concert, that band was sort of at its peak before it broke up. Gene Krupa was playing and Harry James, the trumpet player. The song is like 12.5 minutes long. And when they recorded at Carnegie Hall, there was some different way they recorded it. It was like a radio broadcast or something, so they could record the full jams. Mm-hmm. And when the LP came out, they found these live tapes in a closet. And that was one of the first live albums that came out, and you could hear, because it's Carnegie Hall, there's one mic suspended above the audience. The fidelity is actually better than what you would hear in a studio at that time. And you're hearing the audience roar the way you would at a modern rock concert. And because it's like one incredible mic, you hear everything. And you hear the fidelity of the drums better. So for example, when John Bonham and Zeppelin played in Carnegie Hall, whatever the first time that was in 1970 or something like that, John Bonham was like super stoked because this is where his idol Gene Krupa had played, you know? So I guess one of the things that I love about the drummers of this period was just this kind of go for it attitude. And you can certainly hear that on those tracks on Burn. You know, you guys were saying how you don't really notice that stuff until you separate the tracks, but Paice is just, yeah. I mean, it's epic. It's,
yeah, it's almost amazing. The verse is almost an Ian Paice drum solo. It borders from fill into actually full on solo. But it's interesting you mentioned the jazz thing, because Burn was, we didn't mention it in that episode, but we mentioned it probably a couple of years ago when we did an episode on the album Burn. But the song Burn is based on Fascinating Rhythm, which when you kind of hear that and you
right.
It's they've got these kind of, and Deep Purple was an old jazz tune that they took their name from. So
right,
when you see the drummers of this time, like you brought up, it didn't really occur to me until just listening to you talk, but none of the drummers of this time really had a rock reference drummer. I don't want to say none, but they're all, when you talk to them, you hear Gene Krupa, you hear Buddy Rich, all that sort of stuff. You never hear them say, oh, this rock and roll guy from 10 years ago.
No, they did. Little Richard, there's a guy named Earl Palmer, who's a very legendary drummer who I became good friends with before he passed away, thankfully. Earl's drumming on all the Little Richard records was hugely influential. Do you know the beginning of rock and roll? The drum intro to rock and roll is literally a note for note, we could say, tribute. Thievery, I don't know.
Zeppelin did a lot of tributes.
Yes, a lot of tributes, exactly.
as did Deep Purple.
but the beginning of Little Richard's Keep a Knockin' from 1956, it's literally note for note, and everybody gets it wrong because they think it starts on one, but it actually starts on the and of three. So there's a three note pickup. Da 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 da. So anyway, but Bonham, clearly influenced by Little Richard. I did a two-part podcast about the drumming of John Bonham, which you might want to check out.
Oh, cool.
Or maybe you could put it in the show notes or whatever.
Let me make a note of that. I'll put a link in the show notes.
And I did an Ian Paice podcast too.
Yes, I definitely have that one. And I encourage anyone to take a listen to that, just kind of your history with Ian Paice and going into kind of some of the same details we're covering, but without having to listen to us.
Well... But it's, you know, so, and if you listen to John Bonham's early solos, the stuff he was doing in like 69, 70, he literally takes a Max Roach thing, which is called the drum also waltzes, where it sets up a foot thing. And that's direct, you know, tribute to John Bonham, or to Max Roach. And he does so many things that you can trace them back to the jazz guys. And so in any case, also DJ Fontana, the drummer with Elvis, was incredibly important to a lot of these guys. Sun Records, a guy named J.M. Van Eaton played on a lot of the, you know, like the Blue Suede Shoes, Carl Perkins and Johnny Cash records and things like that. So these guys were listening to all that stuff. And then it was the early 60s stuff too. Link Wray and the Beach Boys, or you know, a lot of that instrumental rock that was coming out at that time. So, you know, that's kind of one of the great things about, and then you had like the Shadows, you know, which were 50s British rock, you know, the band that was backing up Little Richard. Oh God. I'm getting old. My brain is too full. The hard drive is full. Cliff Richards. Thank you.
There you go.
So, you know, it was funny because I just listened to your first Butterfly Ball podcast a couple of days before this, because not the Butterfly Ball, the Jesus Christ Superstar podcast. Okay. And your first episode doesn't even really, you know, it's like just all about the musicians who mm-hmm. played on that record, which is great. And a lot of them were sort of intertwined, as Nigel Tufnell might say, with the with that, you know, there was a huge session scene in England in the 50s and in the 60s. I interviewed some of those drummers too, a guy named Bobby Graham and a guy named Clem Cattini. Clem Cattini was in the running to replace, to be the drummer in the new Yardbirds, AKA Led Zeppelin.
I feel like I just saw the name Clem Cattini like earlier today and I can't remember what context, but I don't know anything else.
Well, you were talking about Lulu, and I don't know, maybe you know who Lulu is by now. Lulu was a huge pop star, teen pop idol in England. Oh, I think her yeah. biggest hit was To Sir With Love from the movie.
Yep.
Well, she was like Petula Clark, who did Downtown and some of those kind of tunes. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I digress. I'm all over the map here because I've been listening a lot to your podcast and trying to tie things in. But it's the whole period of English early rock is really, really cool. I mean, you might have you done stuff about Ritchie Blackmore's beginnings? I would assume probably. Will you talk about the Joe Meek stuff that he did?
We talked a little bit about the Joe Meek stuff and we played a couple of examples of some of his early stuff. We might have played like some Screaming Lord,
the Warlocks,
some other things like that that he had done. We did like a couple of, I'm trying to think back, because it was like episode 3 or something, or right. 2 maybe. When we kind of talked about, and Richie's a guy who was, of course, very young and had a huge session background with all of these other folks. Going into, you know, he probably had like 30 or 40 credits before he even got into Deep Purple, which is pretty
incredible. Like Jimmy Page. I mean, you know, they were both extremely well seasoned. And
but there was that scene at the time, it becomes very incestuous as we get into, I don't know how many albums we've covered at this point, but you start just seeing the same names again and again and again. And you can make these connections to, oh, this person was with them and they played with Deep Purple, or it's very easy to make those, you know, people say 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. Well, with Deep Purple, like sometimes my friends will try to, they know I do this podcast and they don't listen, but they'll just try to be like, well, I bet you can't connect Deep Purple. Somebody said the other day, I bet you can't connect Deep Purple to, I don't even remember what the name of the band was, but I just looked them up on Discogs and I got like 2 steps away from Deep Purple.
Right. Spooky Tooth. See?
Yeah, exactly.
You had mentioned Spooky Tooth. That was another, they were around still when I was a kid. I don't really know. I wasn't a huge fan or anything, but I remember the name pretty well.
It's a great name.
It's a great name. Great name for a band. So just my own personal history. Flash forward. I saw the new Deep Purple in 1980. And then
what are your memories from that show? if you have any, like you said,
I do.
Disappointed, obviously, but what?
Yeah, well, the disappointment, yes, obviously. I was right in the front. I was so excited. Rod Evans had the purple lamé spacesuit you guys talked about. So he was dolled up in that. He wasn't wearing the t-shirt, the casual look.
He looked like he'd borrowed like the under portion of Ace Frehley's getup. Like he had like just like that little like V-neck sort of thing, and that, and then he just, but he, it was like he got interrupted in stealing the spaceman's outfit, and he could, oh, I can only get this, I'll put this on when I'm in concert.
Yes. And I, you know, I thought, I was trying to figure out if the keyboard player was indeed John Lord, because he kind of had this, kind of was going for the look. He had the dark glasses and the, you know, the beard and or the chops. He had the chops, I guess. But definitely the drummer was not Ian Paice. And in looking at the Mexico thing, the Mexico concert that you guys posted, you know, it was really interesting to see all that again. And the other thing I remember is that, I think you even posted the set list, but at some point Rod Evans was like, this song is called Hash. Hash. And I'm like, wow, they wrote a song about hash. You know, I thought, oh, that's so cool. And then they went into Hush, and I knew Hush. And I was like, oh, okay. It's not Hash, it's Hush. But anyway.
And do you,
that's about,
do
you, that's,
I know that in Quebec, I know they did it, but they said this song is, they played Might Just Take Your Life. And they said, this is off of our album Burn, and said, it Might Just Take Your Life, which was where they got into some of the trouble there, which is
right.
He had nothing to do with that album. And they could have worked this in such a way where it was like Rod Evans sings the classics from Mark One and probably had a pretty good run of it. But
yeah,
when he starts saying this is off of our album
that none of them had played on.
Do you remember if they played Might Just Take Your Life?
I don't. I knew that I must have known this song because I have Burn. But you were probably, I don't know if it was in the set list.
Like, what's going on? Like, who are these guys?
Yeah,
like,
and I do remember there was a lot of pissed off people and people were yelling stuff at the stage and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I don't remember the particulars, but it was very, the whole thing was disorganized and felt just really weird. And the audience was not really with them. I think a lot of people felt like I did. I mean, I think they really just didn't, maybe the advertising wasn't really that clear as far as
and back then too, you just didn't know, like Deep Purple's coming, you don't know that,
right?
You're not connected into the rumor mill or any, if this
there's no internet, there's no,
everything would be out on Twitter instantly,
right?
Like, oh, these guys are saying that it's not really them, but
yeah,
who could have known?
Yeah, so here's another interesting story. This is now 1982. I'm in the 10th grade. I go with the same guitar player. Rainbow came to Hawaii. Again, I'm pretty sure that it was a last minute add-on on their way to Asia. And they played also at the University of Hawaii in a different venue. Which
so you were like, I fell for this once. I'm not doing it. You get up.
Yeah, I mean, no, but this was the real Rainbow. This was Joe Lynn Turner and Bobby Rondinelli and that whole crew.
It would have been great if it was like Craig Gruber and like some other instrument and musicians nobody had ever heard
of. Yeah, exactly. but again, it had a sad ending. They played at this place called Andrews Amphitheater, which is a tiny outdoor amphitheater on the university campus maybe holds 1,000 people. It was small. And it was added at the last minute. It was like confusing. It was a festival thing. So I ran right up to the front. I saw the whole show. I was 5 feet from Ritchie Blackmore. But, and this is so hilarious, because by then we were doing local gigs around town and we recognized the guy that was doing the back line, and he was the worst. He always had the worst gear. His stuff was a disaster. So here's Ritchie Blackmore having to use this guy's, and we actually called him the rat because he looked like a drowned rat. He had long scraggly hair. This is 1982. So there was still a lot of hippie stuff left over. And he was always, you know, wasted, stinky shirt, you know, t-shirt or whatever. And and so Ritchie is fucking pissed. He's pissed. Excuse my language. Can I say the F word? Okay. You can bleep me out.
You should hear the guy we had on our last episode.
No. Yeah. First of all, the show was in the middle of the day, so there were no lights. There was no ambiance. You know,
you didn't have the dusk clause for that one.
No dusk clause, and the amps are failing. It's this crappy little amphitheater, and Ritchie, after about 15 minutes, he comes on. They open with Spotlight Kid. I'm all super excited because we were playing Spotlight Kid in our band at this point. He comes on, immediate problems with the amps. They're dying. They're not working right. He's not, you know, and we all know about Ritchie and his reputation or whatever. So he literally takes the guitar, throws it on the ground and walks off stage in the middle of the second or third tune. Uh-huh. You know, he's not jumping around. He's dour and he just throws the guitar down and disappears for like 20 minutes. And I think the band tried to play gamely on for a little while, but then they left the stage too. And finally he came back out and they did the rest of the show, and it was better. But you know, it was so anticlimactic compared to, like, when you look at the famous, what is it, San Antonio, you know, that I think that was like the peak of that band. That's an amazing show. And they didn't have the backup singers. I think, who was playing keyboards at that? Was that Don Airey already? I think it would have been
David Rosenthal at that point. But
well, regardless, it was, you know, it was a great band. I got a Bobby Rondinelli drumstick because he did his thing where he smashes the sticks off the cymbals and they go flying out into the audience. But they had some lame tent overhang, so all the sticks he smashed off the cymbals hit the overhang and fell into the pit where the security was. Oh. So there was like all these Bobby Roninelli drumsticks, and some guy jumped over and started picking them up and handing them out, and I got a Bobby Roninelli drumstick.
Nice.
So, you know, that was pretty cool. So flash forward to 1984, I go to college, and my freshman year of college, Perfect Strangers comes out. I get the album, and I went to see that show. So that was cool, because I got to see Mark II.
Sure.
Did you guys see any of that, those reunion shows? I don't know how old you are.
No, we were a little too young for those. We see some of the people posting ticket stubs from playing right where we both grew up in Rhode Island. So we see like ticket stubs.
It might have been where I saw it.
We could have been at that show if we.
The Providence Civic Center.
Yeah.
Because I went to college at Brandeis University in Boston. So we would go to Worcester.
Did you go to college with Greg? Is that how you know him? Or?
No. But yeah, I only found out later that he was there. He was there after I was there. Yeah, crazy.
Because our good friend who was on the Jesus Christ Superstar episode, he went to Brandeis, and my buddy that I used to run the recording studio with went to Brandeis too. So I spent a lot of time in Waltham and in that general.
Waltham. It was definitely pretty blue collar at that time, and so was Worcester and Providence Civic Center. Those were great places to see concerts. A lot of concerts over the years at those places. Yeah,
we were pretty close to Worcester, but we were just, you know, not quite dialed in enough until the late 80s, early 90s. But it was when we would have started kind of taking note of that stuff and probably still been too young to go to shows at that point.
Yeah. So I really like Perfect Strangers. I think it's a great record. I think the songwriting is great. I think the way they came back and did it was great. But it was the concert kind of started to get into a little bit of shtick, you know, with like they had these sort of glowing things in the background, and when Ritchie did the Beethoven's Ninth thing, you know, and yeah, I was already moving out of my hard rock fandom, you know. As I told Greg Renoff, the turning point for me was Ozzy Osbourne's first solo record. Cause I had been a really big Sabbath fan, and Sabbath, when I first heard them, I don't know for you guys, but like when my buddy gave me that album Paranoid, I was like, it was terrifying. You know, it was like scared the crap out of me, that music. I mean, it was so dark and heavy and all that. And then Ozzy, you know, then they break up or whatever. And Ozzy Osbourne comes back with this really, you know, going off the rails. And I was just like, that set the stage for what rock was going to become, which was no more jams, you know. Also, I know everybody loves Randy Rhoads and he was an amazing guitar player, but it's like Eddie Van Halen revolutionized guitar playing and then everybody else kind of copied it, you know. That's my sort of opinion, but it lost it for me in terms of what I wanted from music, you know, at that
time.
Kind
of like you said earlier about growing out of a phase of a particular style of music too. That was kind of like we came into it a little bit later, and that was kind of the stuff, the era, like we grew up with that early Ozzy stuff. And I must admit, the later Ozzy stuff, I did kind of lose me a little bit, but we just did an episode on Blizzard of Oz, which was monumental in our developing our hard rock sensibilities. And that's kind of where we actually branched off from that early, the first couple of early Ozzy albums, to wanting to find out what happened before that. And then we kind of got stuck in the 70s for a while when discovering Black Sabbath and Deep Purple and all that sort of stuff. And then I know John was a little bit more maybe in touch with what was going on in the mid to late 80s than I was. And I was definitely more of a kind of hippie Beatles, kind of Beatles, Black Sabbath, Deep Purple area. And John was kind of more into that like Kiss sort of stuff. And so we kind of both, but we both came to it from that early Ozzy for one reason or another. But
yeah, I mean, we all have our entry points, I guess. I mean, for me, I feel lucky that my entry point was made in Japan. It set a very high bar. I ran with that, you know, I was a little older, so I got to sort of experience that stuff as it was happening.
Oh yeah.
So then I go through 4 years of college, and I got more into my band. And I got to play in some amazing bands. I was in a Pink Floyd tribute band, and this was before tribute bands. By this point, I was really into Floyd and Genesis and King Crimson and Yes and Gentle Giant, and I was like a full-on prog head. And I think that's what led me finally to jazz, which is more of the final frontier, where like you really are improvising the whole time, you know, that kind of thing. But so I sort of lost touch with Deep Purple at that point. But I kept playing. I was a psychology major. Never thought I was going to be a musician professionally. And I ended up playing in these bands for years. I was also in a Zeppelin band, which was amazing. We would do long jams, and my Pink Floyd band was called The Aesthetic Pig. And we would do like we would do the whole Dark Side of the Moon. We would do all of Wish You Were Here. We would do Echoes part, you know, the first half. And then in the spacey part in the middle, we would do Joe Cocker's Little Help from My Friends, I Want You, She's So Heavy, The Beatles, and Little Wing by Derek and the Dominoes, and then go back into Echoes. So that would be like one set, you know?
Yeah, that's a long set.
Yeah, I mean, it was the funnest thing ever. So when I got done with college, I didn't really know what to do. I didn't want to continue with psychology. That was not my passion. And I started studying jazz with a fantastic teacher who was a Berklee College of Music guy, and decided I was going to be a musician. So I moved to LA, and I got connected eventually with this band called Royal Crown Review, which we got signed to Warner Brothers. Ted Templeman produced our two records. And so the next Deep Purple connection I have is, it's now 1999. I've been out of the world of Deep Purple for a long, long time. I end up, we did a tour, a summer tour with the B-52s and the Pretenders. And we got to do like, you know, the sheds. So like Great Woods, you know, Massachusetts.
Oh yeah.
All of those like summer outdoor venues. We did like 30 of them and was an amazing opportunity to hang with Chrissy Hynde every night. We were all friends, the B-52s. It was like, it was just an incredible, incredible experience. So that was summer of 1998. And we continued to do some spot shows here and there with those bands. I think they were all related to Warner Brothers or on Warner Brothers. So that's how we got grouped, you know, together with them. So like, you know, these dinosaurs, not in a negative way, but these big bands would go out, and then they would add a newer band that was on the roster to tour with them. So in 1999, we had the chance to play the Millennium event for PETA, the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, which is, you know, powerful organization.
By Millennium and event, you mean like a New Year's Eve?
Sort of? It wasn't on New Year's Eve. It happened in December. And this was, you know, Y2K was coming and all that kind of stuff. And we get there and we played earlier in the day, but the headliner that night was Paul McCartney because Linda had died the year or just recently. I think she died in 1999. And so PETA, and of course, they're very famous vegetarians. PETA honored Paul McCartney with they made like a Linda McCartney, an annual Linda McCartney award. So Paul was the first recipient of it. And so he had just released Run Devil Run with David Gilmour on it. And Ian Paice was on it, and band played. They were like the headliner, because we had also played that day. We got to hang on the side of the stage, and I'd sent you a video clip of it, which was their sound check in the afternoon. And it was really an amazing event. I guess PETA is a very powerful organization, because it was on the back lot at the Paramount Studios in LA. They did a sit-down dinner for 5,000 people. So at like round 10, you know, 10 top round tables. Sorry if that's New York.
That's all right. I need to get some of that PETA money. Put together a sit-down dinner for 5,000.
It is insane. And all the celebrities. And on the side, and so we had played earlier, but the B-52s played, the Pretenders played. They're all vegans, those bands, which we learned when we were touring with them. And I was so pumped because, you know, like Tommy Lee and Pamela Anderson were there. They were still canoodling with each other. Bill Maher. I just remember like all these like ridiculous, huge name celebs. And literally while we were watching the B-52s, David Gilmour was standing right next to me. And I'm just like, I had been in a Pink Floyd tribute band. I was the world's biggest fan. I was standing right next to him. But it's one of those things, you don't want to meet your heroes. Cause I actually introduced myself. I was like, yeah, I'm a huge fan. And he just like, he didn't even speak to me. He just sort of like sniffed at me. Ugh. And that was it. But Ian Paice was playing with Paul McCartney. And so the tour manager or production manager for the B-52s or the Pretenders, I knew him from the tour and asked if I could meet Ian. Mm-hmm. And I got to meet him, I think, before they played. Went to his dressing room and we had a really nice conversation, and he was just the nicest guy ever. So that was sort of my first opportunity to actually meet him and watch him play up close, you know, which was cool. It was very, very cool. And he played that, you know, we were a bit snobbish because we were a band that was steeped in a lot of that early rock and roll music and really like were students of history. And I learned so much. That's kind of why I became a music historian, is because of my involvement with that band. And like, you know, they were fiends for collecting. We would do tours across America and we would stop at every antique mall in like Omaha, which was like amazing because you would find all this incredible vintage stuff. You know, we wore vintage suits. We had vintage instrument collections. I have a ton of vintage drums. I did a DVD about vintage drums. You know, we, you know, tie bars, cufflinks, ties. I mean, all this incredible stuff that we were finding. This is before eBay. This is before all that stuff got sold to the Japanese or whatever. Mm-hmm. So anyway, you know, we were sort of, Paul McCartney's going to make a early rock album. And actually, in going back and watching that video a couple of days ago, they did a damn good job. You know, I went and listened to some of the album on YouTube and it sounds really good. And Ian Paice, man, he could have been a top-notch studio drummer. I mean, he really could have. The guy has skills. I mean,
if he ever took a break from being in a band or touring, the only thing he was missing was having the time.
Well, yeah, and he did some very interesting studio work. I looked up his Wikipedia, you know, because he worked with a variety of different artists, kind of like that in that Paul McCartney vein, which wasn't too out of his wheelhouse, but
yeah, I mean, look at just recently, he did a track with DMX a few weeks ago, and
yeah,
which he had to feel the need to. People were so outraged that he'd perform with a hip hop artist that he had to do a video like explaining himself. It's like, don't explain yourself to these people. Do whatever you want to do. You're Ian Paice.
Yeah. I mean, I just wonder how that collaboration came about, you know.
He said that a friend of his asked him to do it. So he's like, "All right, I'll do it." And then of course people are like, "Oh, he must need the money." And he's like, "He doesn't need the money." How much money do you think he's getting for playing drum track to one song like this? And it's just a very odd thing because it came out that morning and like nobody knew this was coming. Everyone's like, Ian Paice is playing on, and then DMX died later on that same day. It was that day.
The video came out.
It was so wow. Strange. I think it was either my daughter's birthday or like the day before or something. It was very odd. But yeah, it was, and you know, he's just asking all these questions because people are like, "Oh, did you play to a click track?" And he released a video, and he's just very, he says, "Of course I played to a click track." He's like, "That's how you make this kind of music." He's like, you know, he was being very nice about answering these really absurd questions, but you know, he's saying, "I didn't receive any fee for this. Someone just asked me to do it, so I did it." And he's like, it's not a style of music I particularly like. Not something I know much about, but I'm always up to try new things. And you know, knowing him, it probably took, you know, maybe an hour or two of his time, and it was over. So.
Well, and he's such a humble guy. I mean, it's you know, I'm trying to. I mean, I love those videos that he puts out. Mm-hmm. What is it, Drum Tribe? Ian Paice, yeah, Drum Tribe, and I never knew what is it. What is the nickname? Everybody?
Oh, the Chief.
The Chief. I had no idea that was his nickname?
I don't think it was. I think it just kind of was like whoever called it Ian Paice Drum Tribe, and then he's like, now he's the chief. I mean, maybe this is something that had been going on for a while behind the scenes. I certainly had never heard of it until
you had never heard of it. Okay, yeah, I had not
heard videos in like lockdown or whatever. But
it's so great because he has so much to share, and he's always like the quiet, you know, like if there he is the lukewarm water of Deep Purple, you know. Not that I don't mean that in a disparaging way. It's just like how he managed to survive all those egos, mm-hmm. and all those addictions, or, you know, God only knows what else they were all up to at that time over the years, and still be there. And I think he's 70 now. His playing is still fantastic. You know,
he had a stroke or something a few years back, like 2016.
Yeah.
And didn't seem to, I mean, I can't notice any real change in his playing or anything.
Yeah. I mean, it was interesting to me when Deep Purple took time off and then they came back and they did Perfect Strangers. And his playing is very different on Perfect Strangers. You know, it's much more controlled. It's much more a typical 80s production, and that he's, you know, you guys mentioned in your Burn podcast, but that he's sticking to the parts, and it's much more like just plain pocket drumming.
Yeah, he's not doing. It's a more of a disciplined album from a production standpoint.
They're yeah,
trying to go for something a little bit more commercial, whether it was intentional or not.
I think loose
kind of feel you get.
On yeah, album. I mean, either he had aged significantly where he didn't feel the need to play in the bombastic way anymore, or the producers, you know, were like, no, this is how you have to make albums now, and you can't do that anymore. You know, which I think maybe. More, I'd love to ask him that question, because it's such a difference in the style where he was so free and filling all the time. It almost didn't matter, you know, what the album was, you know. So it's interesting to me. But when I saw, I was a little disappointed by that. But then, for example, the John Lord tribute concert, what was that, 2015 or something?
2014. Something like that, yeah.
And they do Burn, and he's,
yeah,
just lays it down. And then there's footage of a clinic that he did, you know, on one of his Drum Tribe things. And there's like, can you play Fireball? He's like, no problem. And destroys it and does, you know, I mean, his solo is incredible. So that's the thing, I think. Like, I've seen Bill Ward play recently, and I mean, he can't even play anymore, yeah. You know? I mean, I think that's why he was replaced or quit or whatever on the last final tour or bunch of tours they did. Because of Ian Paice's, and I mean, obviously it's physiology, but I think when you develop an economy of playing that way, jazz, you know, some jazz training or whatever, you can maintain it for longer, you know, and he still sounds great. The last time I saw Deep Purple, they did a tour with orchestras, which I think was around 2011. I had just moved to New York, and we live on the Upper West Side, and they played at the Beacon Theater.
Oh, wow.
And which is a famous theater on the Upper West Side. And my wife got me tickets for my birthday. And I was a little, because you don't want to go see the band after they're, you know, when it's not the band you remember anymore. I'm one of those people, like, I don't really like to go revisit classic rock people, you know, a lot of them. And I also have to say, don't kill me. I love Steve Morse. You know, I saw Steve Morse. I love the Dregs. I was a huge fan. I saw Steve Morse again in Hawaii. Solo acoustic guitar opening up for the One Night in San Francisco guitar trio, John McLaughlin, Paco de Lucia, Al Di Meola. Mm-hmm. I got to see that trio and Steve Morse opening for them, which was amazing. But I can't, I know the newer stuff. I did check out some of the, I haven't been in touch with, you know, the new albums they've done. I'm sorry to say, but I just need Ritchie Blackmore to play those guitar riffs of the old stuff, you know? Right. It's too different for me. And I obviously don't want Steve Morse to try to be Ritchie Blackmore, but that said, it was still a great concert. I mean, they played with an orchestra, and they did Woman from Tokyo which I guess they do a lot, which is awesome because they never got to do that. And we need to talk about Who Do We Think We Are, because it's probably my favorite Deep Purple studio record. That or Fireball. Burn is up there. There's so many. But, you know, it never gets its props. But I'm glad they're doing Women from Tokyo. That was awesome to see. They did a killer version of Black Knight. You know, they did some really great stuff. And it was great. I mean, they're all great musicians. So I feel fortunate I got to see them at that time. Have you guys seen them recently or ever? Or
well, yeah, it was the last show I saw before the October before COVID hit. And
oh, wow.
John saw them right before. I think, John, you saw some other shows after that, right? That was my last show that I've been to.
Yeah, no, I saw some other bands after that, but I can't remember. I got more into live music in the past couple of years than I have been in a while, and then I kind of got shut down.
Yeah, right. So much for that.
Yeah.
So there we go.
You guys asked a question on Twitter about the album What's Next? Is that what it's called? What Comes Now? Deep Purple album.
Oh, now I can't think. What next? Yeah, what next?
But and you say, what's your favorite track off this record? Right, you guys put that on your Twitter page from various albums.
Now what? I'm sorry.
Now what?
You threw me off of the what's next? What? Who do we think we are?
It's not who's next.
Everyone's
anyway. A bunch of people. There was one song that kept coming up, and I went and checked it out, and it was it was really good, man. It was
that's kind of heralded
prog-ish, you know, which I really liked.
That's the first album where Ezrin started producing them, and a lot of you get a lot of varying opinions, but it seems to be the consensus from a lot of people that was the better of the last three albums. But it's also the album that's now 8 years old, so people have a little more time with it. And the new album is, there's always the people that just love everything they put out, and then there's the people that say, oh, I don't like it because it's new.
Right.
Everything has to be a certain number of years old. In 20 years, all these albums are going to be regarded as classics. Who knows?
Yeah, good point.
But yeah, we haven't gotten too much into, we haven't covered anything later than Perfect Strangers from Deep Purple on the show. We're doing a kind of quasi chronological progression with it all. So it's not, because we could have just done all the Deep Purple albums and been done with it, but there's so much related to those side projects and everything that we just decided to kind of swirl around, taking whatever subject comes to mind for that week and talking about it. So we just did Perfect Strangers a couple months ago, after being yelled at by our listeners for the better part of 2 years. And
good. At least your listeners are, you know,
and then
listening.
John stuck with them, I think, through like House of Blue Light, Slaves and Masters, Battle Rages On. He has a little bit more knowledge about that era than I do. I had a pretty good connection to Perfect Strangers, but after that little anything from the late 80s through the early 90s, I was a little bit checked out. So it's kind of, I've heard it all, but it's going to be a little bit more newer territory for me.
Can you clear up when Gillan left again? Did they, was that when Jolin Turner came in?
Yes. Yeah. He was on.
And he do albums or just tour or?
Just he did the one album, the Slaves and Masters, and then did a tour, and then the record company. I think it was for the 25th anniversary. They're like, we gotta have Ian Gillan back, so they coaxed Gillan back. Pissed Blackmore off. They tried to make it work, and it just fell apart after that. But
yeah. Well, it's not, you know, I mean, in some ways, we're lucky that Ian Gillan's solo stuff never really panned out to anything commercially successful, because that always meant, you know, he would be enticed back to come back to Deep Purple.
Yeah, he always seemed to come back, and I think it was just kind of probably pretty evident from the get-go when Perfect Strangers and when they got back together, there was a little honeymoon period there. Then it fell back into its old, the old problems. And I think it was always going to be this power struggle between Ritchie and Ian, and one of them would have to go eventually. And Blackmore decided it would be him. And I think he was just kind of annoyed by the whole situation. I think they both had good reason to be annoyed by the situation. And I mean, obviously people get really like, oh, they should get Ritchie back in the band. It's never going to happen. And if it did, it would be a disaster. And they've been happily pumping out albums for 25 years.
I know.
Now,
I'm happy for them.
With no drama in the band. So
exactly.
Whether I don't think it was all Ritchie's fault, and I don't think it was all Ian Gillan's fault, but clearly the two of them were not a good fit. And I mean, you just see them. If you watch the later concert, like they recorded the video for Come Hell or High Water is like Ritchie's second to last show or something with the band. And you just see the tension, and they're all up there and they're performing and Ritchie's doing his thing. And you could just sense the tension. And then you just go from what I saw them, whatever, a year ago, they're so happy on stage.
Yeah.
They're just laughing and having a great time still. So it's like, clearly it was the right move. And Ritchie's happy as could be too. He's sitting there playing his,
absolutely
playing his Renaissance music and loving it, and smaller venues. And everyone seems really happy. So
yeah. And he had a little rainbow reunion that I saw. I watched a little bit of it on YouTube. I guess he just did like some European shows.
Yeah. It's almost like the same. It's all Blackmore's night. They just kind of changed their clothes. And now they're rainbow.
Well, he found a singer. That sounds an awful lot like Dio.
Yeah, he does. He does a great job of all the rainbow stuff.
Yeah.
Great singer.
Yeah. I have a friend, I guess, doesn't Blackmore live on Long Island? Or did he for a long time?
Or Connecticut, somewhere around there.
Okay. Because I have a friend who's a drummer on Long Island who played with Blackmore for a while. This is before Blackmore's night. I guess he was just doing Blackmore solo stuff. And I asked him, I'm a huge Deep Purple fan. What was it like? Because, you know, you hear a lot of stories about Ritchie Blackmore, obviously, as an employer or as, you know, I mean, that those stories about, I went and checked out a couple Ronnie James Dio interviews, and he was talking about what they did to Tony Carey, you know, and Cozy Powell. I mean, it's just like,
it's awful.
It's, I mean, I was in a band that was like a street gang, you know. It was like three of the guys in the, like, I was, you know, refined. I had a college degree and a good education. Three of the guys in the band never graduated from high school. Mm-hmm. Not that that made them bad people or less of musicians or anything like that, but it was just, we were coming from very different places. And I joined the band, they'd already been going for 5 years. And so I was like the new guy, and there was like hazing, you know. Mm-hmm. So I can only imagine Tony Carey, who was probably a teenager still, you know, at that time, he was just getting started. And here he's dealing with Ritchie and Cozy, who are like veterans of the business. And I mean, but they did some setting fire to his room and locking him in there. Like,
it's, I mean, I was just pranks, astounded. People could have died. You know, it's like, how funny would it have been if, oh, we killed our keyboard player.
Yeah.
Like, that prank went a little too far.
But, you know, that, like, I think things, I mean, that was wild days. I know when I joined Royal Crown Review and we were doing van tours across Texas, driving like 90 miles an hour, and one guy's had an unlicensed gun in the car, and another guy had like tons of weed, you know. And here we are, like, with California plates, going like 100 miles an hour through Texas.
Yeah, everything's probably gonna be fine.
Yeah, totally. Just I mean, the number of times I could have died on the road is
So what did your friend have to say about working with Ritchie?
Well, we never had the conversation, which really pissed me off, because then he ended up moving or something like that. So I never got the goods, but I can imagine. I also ran into Jolynn Turner. Our band was kind of on top of the world in like 98, 99. And we did not only a lot of concerts and touring and working with, you know, bands like the B-52s and the Pretenders and stuff, but we also did a lot of high-end corporate events. And we did this corporate Christmas party in New York, and the other band, everybody wanted us at their corporate party because we were kind of the hot thing, and we were a swing band, and swing was having this resurgence. But there was another band And it was like a dyed-in-the-wool, hardcore New York, like, party band kind of thing. And Jolynn Turner was singing with them. Mm-hmm. They were amazing, like, yeah. Ridiculous. I mean, the guy is an incredible singer. So I talked with him a little bit about having seen him in 1982. Now it's 1990, you know, whatever. I guess 98, 99. And anyway, so, you know, nothing earth-shattering, but just having a chance to meet some of these people that I saw as a starstruck 14-year-old is pretty cool.
Yeah, that's awesome stuff.
When I saw Deep Purple at the Beacon, I had known a guy that had played with Ian Gillan's solo band, and he hooked me up with their management, and I was able to get backstage at that show.
Oh, cool.
And I brought Ian a copy of one of my books, which was all about rhythm and blues drumming. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he ever read it, but that's where I got that picture. That's on the podcast. So I was able to give him one of my historical books, and again, just tell him how much he meant to me, and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. So, and here's one more interesting little tidbit. I have a jazz trio that I've been working with here in New York for quite a while, and it's pretty eclectic. And we are doing a cover of Smoke on the Water on our new record, and
Oh, nice.
I'll send it to you guys when it's mixed. You probably won't even recognize that it was Smoke on the Water, because it's in 3/4 time, and it's very up tempo.
Oh, cool.
And it's very jazzy, but it's cool. You'll dig it. And I mean, Smoke on the Water is probably, you know, my least listened to Deep Purple song, just because I got sick of it from hearing Made in Japan and all, being on the radio, and then everyone making fun of it. Basically, you know, I mean, it's a great song, but
yeah, it's
like wouldn't be my first choice of Deep Purple song to listen to.
No,
when I'm in the right mood.
In some cases.
So. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's kind of become like Freebird, which sucks because it's an amazing song, and the arrangement on Made in Japan is incredible. So I never thought I would ever play Smoke on the Water, let alone in this jazz trio. But what was funny is we did a corporate event, and the guitar player showed up, and he just started riffing on it, and we just kind of went into it, and we ended up, that was sort of our first song that we played at this corporate event. But again, very jazzy, kind of, we did it almost as a joke, and then I thought, this is a really cool arrangement, so let's record this. And then we got serious about it.
Sometimes so it works.
Yeah it's almost like if John Scofield played Smoke on the Water, that's kind of what it would sound like. I don't know if you guys are into John Scofield.
I love John Scofield. I would love to hear that. Well, when you get it, we'll have to
definitely
link to it on the socials or whatever, wherever you decide.
And you can play it on your show. You can play it on YouTube. I will be thrilled. I will not bust you for licensing.
Great. We've got a new opening for the show.
Well, you know, I don't know. You'll have to make that judgment when you see it. But it's cool. It's actually, I'm really, really stoked about it. So I guess for me, maybe that ties up the Deep Purple, my Deep Purple connections. There are probably many more that I haven't mentioned, but it's funny because from the time I was 9 years old and got turned on to hard rock, and now I'm 54, Deep Purple is still there. And I'm amazed that Ian Paice is still there. I mean, he's still playing. He's still active. I don't think you can say that for almost anybody, maybe except Charlie Watts, you know, from that era of especially those great British bands. I mean, they're either all dead or retired or whatever.
You know, we talk about it all the time on the show, but about, you know, how Perfect Strangers came out, and it was like, and you know, the John always brings up that, was it the Steel Wheelchairs tour when Rolling Stones got back to, or not?
Oh, Steel Wheels, yeah.
They were still around, but they call it the Steel Wheelchairs, and Deep Purple was like laughable that in Perfect Strangers came out. These guys,
dinosaurs.
Ian Gillan, he's 39. How can you believe it? These guys are still trying to make this work. It's sad. Look at all these geriatric patients up there on stage. Mad Magazine would have pictures of them with, like, you know, wheelchairs with an IV playing guitars. And
were you into Mad?
Yeah, I was. I remember.
Dude, my dad was into Mad, and he got me into Mad. I started buying Mads in 1975.
Oh, wow. I got a stack of them in the other room.
Yeah, I loved Mad.
But that was kind of my first exposure. I remember seeing, I remember, I don't know who the artist was, but doing this, the old rockers playing.
Yeah.
This 30 years ago.
I know, that was 30 years ago. Yeah,
Gillan just turned 75. And they were when he was 39 trying to do this.
They're making great music, man. The thing that to switch things up, because I have some questions for you guys, if you don't mind my asking, or I have some things I'm hoping to maybe get confirmed. The first of all, the fact that he sang all that Jesus Christ Superstar stuff in like one afternoon.
Yeah, it's
blows me away. And you were dead on in your podcast that like that set the standard for what how everybody sings Jesus. Like there's no other way to sing Jesus, you know? And I'm, you know, Ted Neely. Yeah. You guys have been, we're generous with him, but I would like to hear, I'm sure that he grew into it, but yeah,
I think overall the movie, the sound quality on the movie.
Yes.
I think it's a very well done visual, but
I think a lot of the vocals were overdubbed in very strange ways, and that did not help at all. It did not help him. I think Carl Anderson, on the other hand, rose above. I mean, the Judas is actually maybe even a harder role to sing than Jesus. Unless you're Ian Gillan, and then you set this insane bar that everybody else, all the other Jesuses have to match up to. But that alone, that just blows my mind. And if you think about the output of bands at that time, you know, that these guys were on the road, like Ritchie, I don't know, I was watching some Ritchie interviews, 11 months of the year, mm-hmm. and they're putting out a new album every year. And, you know, they're getting hepatitis and they're probably drinking and drugging it up pretty good all along the way. You know, in Royal Crown Review, we did something like that. I joined the band in 94. We got signed to Warner's in 95. And we put out an album every year, 96, 7, 8, 9. We did four albums in 4 years, which doesn't sound like that big a deal, but we were also on the road like 9 months of every one of those years.
Of course, yeah, it's crazy.
So I've been on that. And you know, Richie's always talking about the managers came in, you know. And it's true, because they want to book you because they're making money. So they just keep booking you, and you're like, everybody's screaming, we need some time off. And, you know, and how you write. But I think that is one of the things that why bands that are on the road so much, their chops are up, their road muscle is up, and they're just in constant creative zone.
Yep.
And that's why, you know, so many of those bands at that time made so much music, as opposed to, you know, the Steely Danification of the recording process. Really, the Beatles were the first to like spend months making a record, you know. I mean, thankfully they did, because it's recording for everybody, but it set a different kind of a standard that you know, just bands make music differently. And what we were saying about how everything has to be perfect.
Yeah.
And obviously now the era that we're in is just a totally different ballgame, but the spontaneity is incredible. Sorry, more emergency vehicles going by us.
I can't tell if it's an ice cream truck or an ambulance. It's got a very odd tone to it.
it's definitely not an ice cream truck. Okay, so questions. Yes. Questions. Since we were talking about Burn, in the Bach section, right, at the end of the keyboard solo, my question is, was this the album that John Lord started to play with synthesizers? Because isn't there a like a Moog part? It's not in the main keyboard solo part. It was in one of the other, think Richie's part. You could hear it in the background, and it doesn't sound like a Hammond organ at all. I mean, I know you could do a lot of stuff with a Hammond, but
I know he was using like an Odyssey before. I want to say maybe, and I'm sure our listeners are way smarter than us, so you should probably ask them.
Right, which is why I'm asking questions.
But I know he had like an Odyssey that he maybe brought out, I want to say in like Fireball. He started playing around a little bit with stuff.
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe around that era. I don't think there was anything on In Rock. And then Who Do We Think We Are? Rap at Blue. He's got some crazy thing going on there.
Yes. So
he started to get really into it. I think it started to play around with it a little bit and then was full on into it. Probably the bulk of the time he was doing it, he wasn't even in Deep Purple. And then when, by the time he came back, it was more, pardon the expression, but more cheesy side, kind of 80s synthesizer stuff. But I think he always had something going on there. But I'm not 100% sure. I'd like to know more about the gear, that the history of the gear, because I just don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's God, hearing those burn tracks was just so cool. And I don't remember if I have any other questions, because I just listened to that podcast this morning, but it was listening to Glenn Hughes' bass part. Was he using a Rickenbacker? Do you know? Was he a Rickenbacker guy? It sounded like a Rickenbacker, like a very Chris Squire kind of sound.
Yeah, from what I understand, he was using a Rickenbacker at like Richie's request. I think he was more of a Fender guy. In a California jam, he's playing a Fender. So I think maybe for the records, Richie was pushing him more towards the Rick. But I'm not 100% sure on that either. But yeah, what a real like just snarling kind of.
Ugly, man. Just ugly in the best possible way. I mean, and he's just on one note.
And you really don't hear much of it in the mix.
No.
That's the kind of beauty of it, which you know way better than we even do, is, you know, you listen to isolated tracks in the studio in order to serve the song by themselves. They don't always sound that great.
And as a listener, I had really pretty much dissected that whole song. But when I heard the bass today, I realized I had never bothered to listen to the bass part at all. So it's interesting.
It doesn't, it's there and it's contributing a lot more than you realize, but it doesn't jump out in the mix particularly.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So another question. The butterfly ball thing, I had not heard of that at all. And I'm surprised, because that would be the kind of thing that I would have known about at the time, or I would have researched, or I would have dug into. What knocks me out about, and I didn't listen to the studio album, although I think I probably should. I think I'd like the studio record. The live albums, or the live concert movie is, it, you know.
The audio is great. The video is questionable.
Yeah, I mean, the ballet dancers and the
very, you know, bizarre.
It's bizarre and sad, because it is great music. So why did you have to, like, I guess it's one of those things where, like, the movie director's vision, he convinced Glover, you know.
Well, I don't think there was any conversation at all. Glover said he was in tears in the theater watching this for the first time. He had no idea that any of this was going to happen. And just was there with his family and friends, just like shrinking into his seat, wanting to.
Oh, wow. Okay. So he wasn't thrilled about it.
No. Yeah. And the thing I've lobbied for years is I would pay top dollar to have just a video of that concert with all the stuff stripped out. As funny as it is, it's just like, you want to like, can I move the curtains? Is there something going on behind that? Is there an actual concert? Because it's the performances on that show are just sensational.
Yeah. And so my big question, which I haven't listened to your Butterfly Ball podcasts, although I'm sure I'll get around to it eventually. But how, you know, Glover was kicked out of Deep Purple unceremoniously in 73, right? I mean, he was fired and was just distraught about it from the interviews I've seen or what I've read about it. Yet, you know, here it's what, 75, 2 years later, he's able to corral, you know, Gillan, Glenn Hughes, Coverdale, Dio, you know, like all his old bandmates are involved. How
John
did he
Lord,
do
John
that?
John Lord was in the live.
Yeah, John Lord.
Live part, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and for material that, it's cool, but like, it's, you know, the subject matter is a little wacky, right? You know, this like Teddy Bear's Picnic kind of thing with all these characters. So how, you know, how did he manage that?
I mean, I think for the most part, he kind of went into A&R for Purple Records, and was a big producer he had really worked on his producing for a couple of years. So he had developed these relationships with a lot of these people. And I think through still being related to Purple Records, it's weird, even though he's fired from Deep Purple, is still kind of kind of tied together with them.
So he moved into the front office, so to speak.
Yeah, I mean, I guess so. And really worked on his production chops. And
boy, did he get that together, man.
Yeah.
I mean, he became a great producer. He produced all those Rainbow albums, right? the Jolin Turner stuff.
Yep.
Once he rejoined the band.
Once he rejoined, and he produced Coverdale's first couple of solo albums. He produced all this stuff. So I think he had this really great relationship with all those guys, even though they were in the band after he left and all that. It seemed to me, anyway, from what I've read, that it was like we talked about this, that scene that was happening around that time, everyone kind of knew each other, and it's just like you're calling up your buddy to, hey, come sing a track on the song. If you watch Coverdale on the live concert, he comes out, he's like, hey, how's everybody doing? And then he's got the lyrics.
I know,
any idea what the words are, he sings them, and then he just kind of goes like this. He just gives them a little salute,
right,
and walks off stage.
Yeah. Because I mean, what was the, I know that I had heard once, and maybe I'm wrong, that Ian Gillan claims that he never ever listened to any of those albums that those guys did. Burn and Stormbringer, and
He still says, I think, but Ozzy says the exact same thing. I never listened to any of the Black Sabbath stuff after.
Yeah, right. Right, right.
Me, it was always the four of us that were the, you know, I don't know.
Pretty good Ozzy impersonation.
That's like my first ever. That's a test drive right there.
Yeah.
But to me, it seems like it kind of reminds, actually, when I was talking to Greg Renoff about it, I remember seeing this quote from Eddie Van Halen about, he's like, I don't listen to music.
Right, right.
And I asked him about that, and his take on it was kind of like, well, I think he says that because he doesn't want anyone to say, like, what do you think of this person? What do you think of that person? He's a living legend. You wouldn't want him to say, like, well, I don't care for that, or I don't listen to that, because it could, he didn't want any of that drama, any of the gossip. So he just was like,
right,
I haven't listened to anything since 1984 or whatever.
Right.
And I kind of get the sense it kind of be the same thing there, is like, he has to have heard some of it at some point, even trying to avoid it. How could you? So maybe it's just kind of his way of saying, getting interviewers off his back to be like, we want.
So he didn't have to.
Yeah. What do you think about the Burn album?
Right. Right.
Now he can just say, I've never heard it.
That makes a hell of a lot of sense. That makes a hell of a lot of sense. Because I mean, one can only imagine, like, what was the backstage vibe, you know, with, you know, Gillan there at the show and Coverdale and Hughes, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't ever think of them being in the same room. You know?
Right, right. And to think they were all like on stage at the same time, Coverdale, Hughes. I don't think Ian Gillan came back for like the big encore, but all of those guys. And Dio would have been there, but Ritchie wouldn't let him.
So. Right, right. Yeah. Well, and when you listen to, you know, the I guess that was the single, the sort of the All You Need Is Love, Love Is All, right? Isn't that what it's called?
It just changed the word.
It's like, oh, yeah. Well, it's got the same kind of shuffling beat. Yeah. I mean, it's very similar. But when you listen to Dio, his voice is even higher than it was in the whole rest of his career. It's like, you know, it's like listening to Robert Plant in 69. His voice is so pristine and just
phenomenal.
Like, so much control of it. And Dio's voice is crazy. It's so high.
Yeah, he steals the show on that album for sure.
Yeah, yeah. But what's also interesting is that the song that Ian Gillan sings is very low key. Like, it's almost maudlin, you know. He's not there's no opportunity for him to scream or do any of his kind of theatrics that he
did
with his
own
voice.
The first Dio track on the album that he sings, and and John Lawton, I think, takes the other ones. But yeah, he does it very, very similar to the way Dio does it too, and they both are very understated on that song, and that's what the song requires. And
right. Yeah. I mean, he's there for the music, you know? Yep. All right. Well, I'm trying to think if I have any other questions. I'm going to hang up and have 10,000 of them, but
yeah, we'll have to, we can answer them on Twitter.
Exactly. Exactly.
Or wherever. But, we really appreciate you stopping by the show and talking about your history with the band and Ian Paice and all these great stories. And, if folks are looking to find more out about you and your podcast and all that sort of stuff, where's the best place to go to find more about Daniel Glass?
Probably my website, which isn't very exciting right now because it doesn't have any gigs on it. But yeah, the podcast, you can find all the podcast episodes. I have a lot of stuff about not only drum drummers, but about music and music history in general. I'm really into the evolution of music. I actually have a DVD called The Century Project, which looks at 100 years of the evolution of American popular music. Awesome. And that talks about the drummer's perspective, because the drum set is very interesting. I mean, we haven't really talked at all about drum or just music history, but the drum set as an instrument has a fascinating history. It basically came together because they were, you know, you had three members of a marching band, three distinct drummers, bass drum, snare drum, and cymbal player. I mean, you might have had multiples of those, and that was a military tradition. But after the Civil War, there were a lot of musicians because so many there had been so much military activity, and of course musicians were the ones that were the communicators. There were no walkie-talkies or anything like that, obviously. So the drum calls would tell people when to get up and when to charge, and you know, that's how people knew, and the bugles and the fifes. So there were a ton of musicians, and because the country was united, now commerce, entertainment, these kinds of things could evolve. And so that's when, you know, minstrelsy became popular and traveling circus shows and vaudeville started to emerge. Was sort of like, well, we don't have the budget for three guys, but we could hire one if we can figure out a way to put together the drums into a unit, you know, or we have no room in the orchestra pit at the vaudeville theater. So the drum set really came into being. The bass drum pedal, very, very primitive versions of it, were created around the time of the Civil War, even a little earlier. And so that's where the story of the drum set really begins. Also, the fact that slaves were freed, theoretically, I mean, at the end of the Civil War, you know, at least on paper, allowed Black people to start to participate in American culture. And it took another 30 years until you have ragtime, but that, you know, African American approach to rhythm is a big part of what makes the drum set special and unique. Obviously, all of it kind of coming together in New Orleans with jazz. But it's a really wonderful story, and the evolution of the gear itself is also really fascinating, because the different parts of the drum set come from different immigrant groups that came to the US. So for example, tom-toms are originally of Chinese origin. They had temple blocks on the drum set, which, by the way, I think Ian Paice is playing on, what is it? The
You Fool No One?
No. The Shield, going way back.
Oh.
Those little It's either an African slit drum. That was another question I had, if anybody knew that. It's either an African slit drum or it's temple blocks.
Oh.
That's really cool. But that was a standard part of every drum set. And certainly in his time as a young man, they would have had, you know, temple blocks. China cymbals, right? The upside down cymbals. Those are Chinese origin. And of course, the Zildjian family came from, you know, Turkey, and Paice cymbals that Bonham and Paice uses were originally European cymbal technology. They're still made in, you know, the company's Swiss. So you have all of these different pieces coming together to create the drum set. And when did the hi-hat show up? You know, that showed up in the early 30s. We first start hearing that in like 1930, that, you know, instead of having to choke a cymbal, which is what they did in the 20s, needed two hands to do that. So then they had these little devices they would hold that had two cymbals, and they'd hit them with a stick, two cymbals. You hear that on certain records. And then they were like, well, we have this one foot pedal, let's add another foot pedal, you know. So then they started, that was called a low boy. It was down on the floor like the bass drum pedal, and you would clop two cymbals together to sort of the chick to the boom of the bass drum, boom chick, boom chick. And then it's all happened like in a short amount of time, but then they said, well, why don't we raise it up, then you could play it with your hands and with your foot. So, you know, these stories are very interesting, and how Gene Krupa fits in and just how important he was. People know his name, but they don't really realize that he was like, I mean, the world that the modern drummer exists in would not be what it is without Gene Krupa on so many levels. He was like the first true superstar of the drums, and was responsible for example, tom-toms being, you could tune the top and bottom head. Prior to that, they were the original Chinese design where the heads were tacked on with little nails, you know, decorative nails. Couldn't tune it. If you broke it, you were SOL. You'd have to change the head or get another drum or whatever. But it was not easy to obviously change those heads. So it's a fascinating story. And when the ride cymbal came in, which wasn't until bebop, and the only reason it came in is because the cymbal tilter was invented. So for the first time, they could tilt the cymbal towards the drummer so that they could keep time on the cymbal, and they used bigger cymbals. So very interesting. And it's a, I take it all the way up to Ringo, because by the time we get to Ringo, the drum set is the blueprint that really it still is today. The modern design, the modern way it's used. And one thing that that Ringo did on Ed Sullivan was he played match grip, which was very unusual for the time. The every drummer, you know, there was no other way to play except the traditional grip. And when Ringo, you know, that had caused such a sea change that literally that became the way that drummers played overnight because of Ringo. And because of the baby boom generation, who were all primed and ready to, you know, become the Beatles, to be self, you know, singer-songwriters, essentially. That was also something that wasn't done very much before then. Buddy Holly, Sam Cooke, you can find a few examples of people that wrote their own songs, performed their own songs, you know, produced, were in charge of their career. Normally, it was like you had musicians, you had the artist, and you had a producer, and you know, those three things were independent jobs, and a songwriter. Songwriters would, they were all independent, and the idea of somebody writing their own songs was unheard of.
It seems so obvious now, like you just do it yourself, but yeah, it just wasn't the standard.
Just wasn't standard because the songwriters could write the hell out of a song, and the musicians could, in, you know, in a 3-hour session, do three tunes very well, which, as we know, when rock musicians came up, I mean, the Wrecking Crew played on all the, you know, all these albums that are credited to the band who never really played on it. So, I mean, it again, wasn't the Beatles just changed everything. And, but anyway, well, I, as you can tell, I'm into this. I'm into this stuff.
I feel like I've learned more about the history of the drum set in the past few minutes than I ever thought to look
would
into.
Care
it
to ma- know.
It makes no sense. And when you all I could think of when you were saying that is like how it must have seemed almost comical at us early on when you see this one guy playing three different things. He looks ridiculous. He's fitting this with his foot and he's doing. You know what I mean? Like, and now it, but it's the, like the coolest thing in the world now, and everybody does it and wouldn't think of doing it any other way. But the way that you described it, it makes perfect sense. It's fascinating that it goes from wartime to right up to Ringo, all those changes that happened. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah. It's an amazing story. That 100 year path that winds its way along. I'd be happy to send you a copy if you're interested.
It'd be great. You know, I'd love to.
Cause it's, even if you're not a drummer, it's pretty interesting. I mean, there's just a lot of cool history. One other thing I'll say about Ian Paice's gear that I learned from one of his Drum Tribe videos where he does his stage, you know, he shows you his stage kit, is that he's basically playing a 4-piece kit, which is kick, snare, one rack, and one floor. But all the rest, he says, is almost even cosmetic, and it's there just, you know, for effect. But that shows his old school nature. And the reason why is because his ride cymbal is very low, so he can't have two toms mounted on top of the bass drum, because that's another old school kind of, you know, tradition. Fact that he plays 14 by 26 inch bass drum, huge bass drum, swing era right there. Nothing, no muffling. One of the things about Ian Paice, too, that I really forgot to mention is his incredible bass drum ability. He has, as opposed to a lot of those bands, as opposed to, I would say, rock drumming in general, where the bass drum is kind of, at least at that time, was almost more of an afterthought. Coming from jazz, where it was a soft, because they had those huge bass drums, you know, back in the 20s when there was no amplification, there was no microphones, you know, so the drummer if we think drummers get yelled at now for playing too loud, imagine how it was in the 20s when you had like a clarinet and a cornet and an acoustic guitar or a banjo and an upright bass or a tuba with no amplification. And here you have a 28-inch bass drum and the same snare drum we have today. So, you know, but that was the standard. And all those early rock guys, again, from Gene Krupa, were like playing these open things. But the swing guys played the bass drum very quietly. You know, the bass drum was underneath. They played what was called a four on the floor feel. They did what was called feathering the bass drum. So when the rockers showed up, you know, now they're hitting that bass drum solidly. But a lot of them, you know, you listen to the way his Ludwigs were recorded and the way that that bass drum just pops. Listening to the Burn thing, he's got a super active foot, you know, much more than a lot of other drummers. It's like, you know, that's hard. That's really hard to do at those tempos, at that volume. You listen to Made in Japan, he does that thing with his bass drum where he speeds up. And then, I mean, there's no one in that rock world that could play the bass drum as fast as that. A single bass drum, which is again why I think he doesn't use the double pedal very much, because he doesn't, you know. Buddy Rich would always say, why do I need two bass drums? I could do everything I need to on one bass drum.
Right.
He also had a ridiculous foot. So I think, you know, something else that really sets Ian Paice apart, in addition to his jazz chops, his economy of playing, his incredible sense of time, you know, in pre-click track era. I mean, you listen to a lot of Bonham stuff, it's really moves around. When the levee breaks, there's those sections where the whole song slows down and then speeds up again. And all, you know, that was, you wouldn't fault anybody for doing that.
Sure.
But Paice, boom, incredible internal clock. So I just wanted to get that in about the bass drum.
I appreciate that. Yeah, it's pretty incredible. He only really used the double bass on that one on Fireball.
Nothing on Fireball,
else,
yeah.
Ever again.
Yeah. It is kind of mind blowing. But you know, it's like he has the double pedal, and on that clinic, he just sits down and plays Fireball he didn't even have to adjust himself. He just sits down and goes, you know, incredible. The other thing that I love about Paice is that he plays with all those Deep Purple tribute bands in Europe.
Yeah. He's sat in with quite a few.
How humble is that? You know, like he doesn't have a big ego about it. Yep. And probably for him, it's fun to play the material that he doesn't get to play with the current iteration of the band. So they probably all do Burn, you know, and stuff from those records. And they're probably all super fans. So maybe they're doing some of the Come Taste the Band stuff or stuff from the Rod Evans period, you know.
And here you are, you just made some young musician's day, or the story they're going to tell for the rest of their life. You know, that's great.
Yeah. I mean, good for him. You know, that's the way to do it. That's what keeps you, you know, I'll be 55 in a couple of weeks, and my body's kind of beat up from years and years of touring. But what I love and what keeps me going as a musician is the variety. I play a gig at Birdland in New York every Monday when there is a New York and when there is a Birdland. I've done it for 9 years now, and it's a pretty amazing, it's an open mic night, but it's at one of the most famous jazz clubs in the world. So the house trio is incredible. The piano player was Liza Minnelli's music director for 25 years, but everybody in the band like knows, has an enormous repertoire, and mostly singers come up, although we get tap dancers, we get jazz players. It's a lot of really heavy Broadway people, like maybe you wouldn't know them in the real world, but in the New York scene and in Broadway, people that were in the original production of Les Mis and this and that. People like Bette Midler have come in. Kenny Loggins, Weird Al Yankovic. It's one of those nights that's become an institution. And when you're in New York, it's a really entertaining night. The host is hilarious, very, you know, super witty guy. Nobody from Deep Purple has ever come in, but you know who came in and hung out was Leland Sklar. That was
really
pretty awesome. Oh, yeah.
Right.
I mean, when somebody like that is there and I'm playing, you know, because it's a long night, it's like a 3-hour night. We never know what's coming, who's going to be there. People just come in off the street. You never know. Everybody from Donny Osmond to Gunnar Nelson. I mean, it's like the most eclectic But if you're a singer, it's a killer band, and you know, we play everything. So that I love, like that kind of a gig is something I love. It's super challenging. It's a bit terrifying sometimes because it's like, you know, there's always heavies in the audience and you gotta bring it, you know, yeah. Whether it's a Sinatra standard or we played Don't Stop Believing before as a jazz trio with a tiny little, that was not easy. But it's fun. And it's the thing that keeps me going is like the opportunity to play a really wide variety of music. So my point is I can understand why Ian Paice would want to, like, I could not see being in the same band for 40 years. You know, I mean, it's when you're playing the same repertoire night after night, you know, I've been there and that's not my ideal. You know, it's cool to be a rock star and play in front of big audiences, but what's that?
Takes a special kind of person to be able to do that. I can't imagine how you could do it either.
You know, but I think that's just his, that's why he's the only original member, so to speak. It's just because he just keeps on chugging and he doesn't, you know, he just seems like, I love those episodes because he's such a real person, you know, he's just telling these stories about whatever. Meanwhile, he freaking played with David Gilmour and Paul McCartney in the same band. I mean, you know, for those of us, it's like, like,
he's a great drummer, even better guy. And I think as long as he's around, Deep Purple will be around in some form. And who knows when they're all going to hang it up eventually. But he's been there for 53 years. And
that's unbelievable.
Keep on going.
And have you, I know Glenn Hughes follows the podcast on Twitter. He's liked a bunch of stuff, which is cool. Do any of the other band members, have you had any opportunity to interview them? Have any of them been on the podcast?
We've had Don Airey on the show.
Cool.
We've had kind of some back and forth with David Coverdale and Glenn Hughes, but nothing more than just kind of some, just like kind of Twitter jokes and things, but. They're great too. They're great guys who will entertain talking to a couple of numbskulls like us about Deep Purple stuff. So we appreciate it.
Hey man, what I have to say again, what you guys are doing is amazing, and I thank you for it. I hope you have continued success. I mean, I've been listening to Deep Purple for over 40 years, and you know, it's like to be able to hang with people like-minded folks, and get into the nitty gritty and share my own experiences. You know, I appreciate you offering me the forum to blather on about my own, you know, feelings about these subjects.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And thank you for your kind words about the show. We really appreciate that. And lending your expertise about the technical side of it, which we don't pretend to understand. So we really appreciate that. So.
Well, if you let me know when the air date happens, I have a pretty good mailing list, and I'm sure we'll get some people listening. Definitely.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for stopping by.
Sure, man. Absolutely, my pleasure. John, you got to stop talking so much, man. You really dominated the conversation tonight.
He's the Ed McMahon of the show. For interview segments, anyway.
You do a lot of
When it comes,
go ahead.
Yeah, when it comes to interviews, I usually just hang back and listen.
Cause you have a lot to say. You're a chatterbox on the other interviews or the other, you know, the podcasts I've listened to thus far. So,
I mean, I try not to force it. If, you know, if there's nowhere for me to jump in, I just kind of listen. And it's been really, everything you said has been really fascinating. So I don't want you to take that as that, I wasn't, engaged, because it was you had a lot of interesting stories, so it was great to have you on.
Well, thanks, man. And okay, one more question. Sorry, this probably has no answer. On the version of Lazy from Made in Japan, you know, they modulate right before Gillan starts singing. They do the lick and then he comes in, he sings the first two lines. Oh, no, he sings the first chorus of the blues. You don't want no money. You don't want no bread. Mm-hmm. Oh, shut up. And then he, oh, am I crying? Now, I always wondered, Was he talking to somebody in the band or somebody in the audience, or was he talking to the chick that the song is written about? I assume it's a chick. Maybe it's a guy. I don't know. Do you even know the reference that I'm making?
Yeah. But I never thought of it in that context before. I guess I always thought of it was like, shut up talking to the person.
Yeah.
Did you ever think about it, John?
My guess is it's probably like, you remember the Denmark concert when he was just like, he was leaning over and he's like, oi, yeah. oi, you know, and he's like pointing. And I was like, what's he doing that for? And then I didn't.
And he's like,
yeah, I didn't realize that he was like, yeah, he was yelling at somebody in the audience. It was obviously causing problems. So maybe he saw somebody in the audience and he was like, hey, shut up. And then he went back to the song.
It's so weird because there's not a lot of room.
I guess.
Yeah. There's not a lot of room for him to get that in. And then he's got to immediately sing the next line. So it seems odd.
It's funny. The second you said that, I was thinking the Denmark thing. I knew where John's mind was going. Yeah.
So what is this Denmark thing? Is that the concert from right around the same time as Made in Japan? There is a concert that's been on YouTube for a long time.
It's earlier in 72. It's like April-ish or something. And
where they're kind of doing the same.
Similar set.
Yeah.
And yeah, at the very beginning, I think they're playing, is it Highway Star, John? Yeah, they're like very early on in the show, and then he sings maybe the first verse, and then he starts like wagging his finger and like, oh, like John said, oh, and he's like gesturing like get them out of here. So I don't know if there was a fight down in front or what it could have been. And but it seemed like the Japanese audience was very tame, though. I can't imagine
him
up to any of them.
Yeah, that's true. I love at the end of Space Trucking how like the whole thing happens, and then John Lord does the spaceship landing.
And there's just
and nobody says, they're all stunned. And finally, it's just like the old, and then they're like, rah! You know, it's too awesome. It is, I think that Space Truck and Jam, and I know it comes from Mandrake Root and a bunch of other stuff they already were doing, but they just like, that was they just put that together. That whole, I have that jam like memorized. Mm-hmm. You know, I could sing you the whole freaking, I won't, trust me, but I love that so much. I have one more story. I lied. One more quick story. My dog is scratching at the door. He wants to come in. So a couple of years ago, you know, Sky Sports and Sky Entertainment, like in the UK. So it's kind of like a commercial competitor to the BBC. And they have Sky Arts. Sky Arts did a 4-part series about drummers. Mm-hmm. And they have huge name people in it, including Ian Paice. And the guy somehow looked up, did a lot of history about drummers and saw that I was a historian. So when they were in New York, they traveled all over the US and all over the UK and probably other parts of Europe interviewing drummers. It's a pretty cool show, 4 parts. And they interviewed me. And the guy that was doing it just got really into the stories I was telling. And I told him that I was a Deep Purple fan and that Ian Paice was my first drum hero. So I did this thing where I play along with Rock Around the Clock. And I talk about, you know, they bring me in as the drum historian. I talk about Rock Around the Clock and how that related to drumming and all this kind of stuff. But then he said, so we interviewed Chad Smith and he's playing Highway Star. Mm-hmm. And we have Ian Paice playing Highway Star. I guess everybody played along to the recording. Mm-hmm. And he said, would you like to play Highway Star? And I was like, are you effing kidding me? Yes. So I played along to like the first 5 minutes or something, 3 minutes of Highway Star from Made in Japan. Mm-hmm. And he was like, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you and Ian and Chad Smith on screen all at the same time, all playing Highway Star to show the originator and two guys from like different sectors of the drum world. And when the thing came out, I was nowhere to be seen. It was only Chad Smith. And I guess I hit the cutting room floor. I was like crushed, man. I mean, that would have been like a highlight of my life to at least be on the same screen as Ian Paice playing, you know, that amazing iconic drum part.
We got to get that footage.
Yeah, exactly. I should write to the guy and be like, hey, Where's the footage? So, okay, that's it. I'm done with stories.
Thank you once again for stopping by. And when you want to record on your own, you singing the entirety of Space Truck and send it to us, and we'll put it up as a bonus episode.
Maybe by episode 209, you'll be needing content like that to prop things up.
Yeah, we got a special treat for you this week. John and I are taking the week off.
Right. Anyway, but also the opening, the way that Deep Purple opened their concerts during both Mach 2 and Mach 3 is just so awesome. Yeah. The opening of Cal Jam, come on. Like, it always just sounds like they're sort of warming up or something.
Like approaching.
And then all of a sudden it just turns into music. And those little things that John Lord does, and Ritchie's always, always tuning. Well, because when you have that big whammy bar,
yeah, you use it like he does. Yeah,
exactly. I have to say also, sorry, listening to the Burn thing today and hearing his tracks, it's amazing how different his version of Stratocaster and Marshall amp is from, say, David Gilmour's or Jimi Hendrix or however many other guitar players use that same combination, and yet totally different sound.
Well, it's just like every guy that walked into a guitar center or whatever and bought a Strat and a Marshall stack and thought he'd go home and sound like one of those guys.
Right.
And didn't sound like any of them.
it sounded like
a guy who doesn't know how to play the Strat very well,
Yeah, so, exactly. So much. I mean, it's just so cool. So anyway, stop me before I talk again. And thank you guys.
All right. Thank you. Thanks so much for stopping by. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple Podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.